How long has this been happening? Have you known the whole time? Who's doing it? Why me, of all people? Is what I'm even saying? Am I actually saying it? Or is it just them putting the words in my head? I don't know. It's really hard to get it straight.
Considered a modern Christmas classic, or it was a classic Christmas classic. It's, you know, it came out back in like 90s, so it's not a modern classic. It's more so a classic Christmas classic, you know? Everyone loves it. Everyone watched it when it comes out on, you know, cable channels for those who still have cable. And we're going to go over how it was made. This is Home Alone. Writer and producer John Hughes conceived Home Alone while preparing to go on vacation. He said, "I was going away on vacation, making a list of everything I didn't want to forget. I thought, well, I better not forget my kids. Then I thought, what if I left my 10-year-old son at home?
I keep having this nagging feeling that I've forgotten something."
"Hey, if you forgot it, it probably wasn't all that important."
"Yeah, I guess."
What would he do? Hughes wrote 8 pages of notes that developed into the screenplay. Imagining that children are naturally most scared of robbers, Hughes also worked that aspect into the plot of the film. Home Alone was initially set to be financed and distributed by Warner Bros. Hughes promised that he could make the movie for less than $10 million, considerably less than most feature film production budgets of that era. Concerned that the film might exceed that amount, Hughes met secretly with 20th Century Fox before production to see if they could fund the project if Warner Bros. Couldn't. According to executive producer Scott Rosenfeld, a copy of the script was secretly delivered to Fox, bypassing the legal restrictions that would have otherwise prevented Fox from seeing it until the project was in turnaround. Early in production, the budget grew to $14.7 million. Warner demanded that it be cut by $1.2 million. The producers responded with a memo arguing that the budget could not be cut any further. Unconvinced, Warner shut down production the next day, but it quickly resumed when Fox took up Hughes on his offer. The final budget was $18 million. Hughes had asked Patrick Reed Johnson to direct, but he was committed to directing Space Invaders. He turned to Chris Columbus, who had left National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation before shooting had started because of personality clouds of starring actor Chevy Chase, who Columbus said treated him like dirt. Hughes gave him the scripts for both Home Alone and Reach the Rock. Columbus chose to direct Home Alone, as he found it funnier and liked the Christmas theme. Columbus had an uncredited rewrite of the script, which included the character Old Man Marley. He added the character to give the story a more serious layer, as well as a more emotional ending. Hughes suggested to Columbus that they cast Macaulay Culkin as Kevin because of his experience while shooting Uncle Buck. Columbus met with 200 other actors for the part, as he felt it was directorial responsibility. John Mulaney was asked to audition for the role for Kevin, but his parents declined. Columbus finally met with Culkin and agreed he was the right choice. After Robert De Niro and John Lovitz turned on the role for Harry, Joe Pesci had accepted it. The role of Uncle Frank was written for Kelsey Grammer, but was given to Gary Bauman when Grammer was unavailable. Daniel Stern was cast as Marv, but before shooting had started, he was told that the production schedule had been extended from 6 weeks to 8 weeks. He dropped out as he would not have been paid for the extended schedule. Daniel Roebuck was hired to replace him, but after 2 days of rehearsals, Columbus felt he was lacking chemistry with Pesci and brought back Stern. Roebuck later said that, although he wasn't set to be fired from the production, he now believed the experience was a little blip of unimportance.
"Well, that just sort of happened to me. I mean, I didn't even participate in that."
Chris Farley auditioned for the role of Santa Claus impersonator, but he failed to impress Columbus. John Candy was available for only 1 day to film his scenes, which took 23 hours to shoot. He was only paid $414 since he did the film as a favor to Hughes. In return, he was the only actor Hughes allowed to go off script. According to Columbus, all of his dialogue was improvised. Principal photography took place from Valentine's Day in 1990 to May 8th of 1990. Over the course of 83 days, the house exterior scenes were filmed on location at a three-story single-family house located at 671 Lincoln Avenue in the North Shore Village of Wickinetta, Illinois, where Hughes' previous films, The Breakfast Club, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, 16 Candles, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, She's Having a Baby, and Uncle Buck had also been shot. The only interiors of the house used for filming in the film were the main staircase, basement, attic, and most of the first floor landing, while all the other interiors of the house, including the aforementioned rooms, were duplicated on a soundstage to allow more room for equipment and crew. It was built in the gym and empty swimming pool of the former New Trier High School building, previously used by Hughes for Uncle Buck and Ferris Bueller's Day Off, where the production company had already set up its offices. The treehouse in the backyard was built specifically for the film and dismantled after filming ended. The church exteriors were shot at Trinity United Methodist Church of Wilmette, Illinois, while the interiors were shot at the Trace Espinel Church in Oak Park, Illinois. For the film within a film, Angels with Filthy Souls, shooting took only one day on the final test day prior to the official start of principal photography. To create the illusion that the film was an authentic 1940s gangster film, the scene was filmed on black and white negative film, and Johnny's office featured props from that era. Like much of the film, most of the sequence was shot with low, wide angles that, according to journalist Darren Kane, captured the action as if a child were perceiving it. Cinematographer Julia McCatt recalled that Pesci was more difficult to work with than Colton. The older actor believed that some of the dialogue was not of quality with his acting ability. He also resented the early unit calls since they prevented him from starting his day with nine holes of golf, as he preferred to do. After the assistant director by the car one day to complain about this, daily call times were moved back from 7 to 9 a.m. to accommodate his rounds. On the other end of the schedule, the crew had limited time to film the many nighttime scenes since Culkin could not work any later than 10 p.m. due to his age. On the set, Pesci and Stern both had difficulty refraining from cursing, which became annoying to Pesci since Culkin was on set as well. In fact, the only curse word that made it to the film was shit, accidentally said by Daniel Stern when his shoe fell through the doggy door, and hell, which was said by both Pesci and Stern after a character encountered one another after going through Kevin's booby traps, and by Johnny to the character of Snakes in the film within a film, Angels with Deadly Souls. Pesci's use of cartoon cursing or menacing gibberish garnered comparisons to Looney Tunes characters Yosemite Sam.
Fat, dirty, Perkish, Harkaback, Flatten, Barton, Philip, Bucket, Barton,
fuck!
The film's stunts also created tension for the crew during shooting. Columbus said, every time the stunt guys did one of those stunts, it wasn't funny. We'd watch it, and I would just pray that the guys were alive. Stunts were originally prepared with safety harnesses, but because of their visibility on camera, the film's final stunts were performed without them. Troy Brown and Leo DeLandi were stuntmen for Pesci and Stern, respectively. According to BuzzFeed, an injury had occurred between Pesci and Coulson during one of their rehearsals for the scene in which Harry tries to bite off Kevin's finger. Colton still has the scar. The tarantula that walks on Stern's face was actually real. Senta Moses, who played Tracy, recalled in 2020 that one of the most difficult scenes to shoot was the family run through the O'Hare International Airport to catch their flight. While it does not last long, it required several days to film. There were thousands of extras, all expertly choreographed so none of us would be in danger running at full speed through the American Airlines terminal, she told a Hollywood Reporter. And we ran at full speed, sometimes we bumped into each other like a multi-car pileup on the expressway and just crack up laughing. There were so many setups and narrowly missed moments of disaster, but to my knowledge, no one was hurt.
Linda, I'm not really your boyfriend. I'm an actor.
What?
This house. It's just a set. Your parents? They're extras.
Oh, Mac.
Here, have a Sprite. See, Linda? It's all an illusion. The only thing that isn't fake is this and us.
All right, come on, where's the light? Nope. No, that's not it. Okay. I had to turn off the power in this place for a minute because, you know, that commercial was just blaring through my, you know, through the video. I'm sorry about that. I'm just going to wait it out a little bit and, you know, we'll get back to the review. Yeah, we just got to, you know, wait it out just a little bit. Yeah, hopefully it'll begin working again, you know, begin working like it's supposed to, you know? That's dumb fury. Okay, I'm just gonna. I will get back to you guys. That's not the right button. How do you turn? Okay. Columbus initially hoped to have Bruce Broughton score the film, and early posters listed him as the composer. However, Broughton was busy with the Rescuers Down Under, and he had to cancel at the last minute. Columbus was later able to get in touch with Steven Spielberg, who had helped him contact John Williams to produce the final score. Traditional Christmas songs such as Oh, Holy Night and Carol the Bells are featured prominently in the film, as well as the film's theme song, Somewhere in My Memory. The soundtrack was released by Sony Classical Records on cassette on December 4th of 1990, and on CD on May 27th of 2015. Home Alone premiered in Chicago on November 10th of 1990. It was given a wide release on November 16th of 1990. Home Alone grossed $285.8 million in the United States and Canada, and $190.9 million in other countries for a worldwide total of $476.7 million. It gets a production budget of $18 million. In its opening weekend, Home Alone grossed to $17 million from 1,202 theaters, averaging 14,211 per site, and just 6% of the final total, and had screens over the next 6 weeks, with a peak screen count of 2,174 during its eighth weekend at the start of January 1991. By the time the film had run its course in theaters, Home Alone was the third highest grossing film of all time worldwide, as well as the United States and Canada, behind only Star Wars and E.T. the Extraterrestrial. According to the home video box, Box Office Mojo estimates that the film sold over 67.7 million tickets in the United States. It was also the highest-grossing Christmas film until it was surpassed by Dr. Seuss's The Grinch in 2018. The film made Culkin a child star, and we all know what happens to child stars. On Rotten Tomatoes, Home Alone holds an approval rating of 66% based on 58 reviews, with an average rating of 5.8 out of 10. This is nonsense. Home Alone's uneven but frequently funny premise stretches unreasonably thin and is boiled by McCoy Culkin's cute performance and strong supporting stars. Shut up. The 1989 French horror thriller film 3615 Killer Père Noël, which is about a young boy who's home alone with an elderly grandfather and has to fend off a home invader dressed up as Santa Claus, has been noted for its plot similarities to Home Alone. 3615 Killer Père Noël director Renes Manor friend the producer of Home Alone with legal action on the grounds of plagiarism, alleging Home Alone was a remake of his film. It was not released in the United States during its original theatrical run in January 1990 and did not become widely available there until 2018. I don't know what the result of that was, but... I don't really care. The music video for Snoop Dogg's 1994 song Gin and Juice opens with a gag where, after teenage Snoop's parents have left him to watch the house in his absence, he places his hands to his face and yells in the manner of Kevin McAllister in the first film, while Tyler comes along reading Homeboy Alone. In December 2015, Culkin reprised his role as an adult Kevin McAllister in the inaugural episode of the Jack Dissel web series Drivers, where a visibly disturbed Kevin recounts his experience of being left home alone by his family. In response to Culkin's video, Daniel Stern appeared in a short video reprising his role as Marv, released in conjunction with Stern's Reddit anime, where he pleads for Harry to return to help protect him against Kevin's traps. The 2016 Christmas set horror film Better Watch Out includes a scene where a character who's obsessed with the Home Alone films demonstrates how, in real life, it would be deadly for someone to be hit in the face with a paint can swung from a distance.
Look what you did, you little jerk!
On December 15, 2018, Culkin made a guest appearance as himself in an episode of The Angry Video Game Nerd to review multiple video game adaptations of the first two Home Alone films, as well as a gameplay session of The Page Master with James Rolfe and Mike Matheny in the days following the episode's release. On December 19th that same year, Culkin was once again reprised the role as an adult Kevin McAllister in a 67 ad time for Google Assistant, titled Home Alone Again. The commercial contained shot-for-shot remakes of the scenes from the film. Google Assistant helps Kevin set up the house, look actively by remotely turning on lights, devices, and setting up cutouts of people in order to have the thieves parked in a van outside. Presumably, Harry and Marv steer clear of the house. Additionally, Joe Pesci also reprised his role as Harry, only for his voice acting making a small cameo. Pesci later appeared in another ad where he watched the show with his friends and jokes about his brief cameo. Am I advertising Google Home? I get this done. Home Alone was novelized by Todd Strasser and published by Scholastic in 1990 to coincide with the film. On October 15th, 2015, to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the movie, an illustrated book by Kim Smith and Quirk Books was released. The film was followed by a commercially successful sequel in 1992, Home Alone 2 Lost in New York, which brought back most of the first film's cast. Culkin was paid $4.5 million to appear in the sequel, compared to the $100,000 for the original. The film within a film, Angel for the Souls, has a sequel in Home Alone 2, Angels Even Filthier Souls. Both Angels metal films set feature characters actor Ralph Foody as stereotypical 1930s mobster Johnny. A third film, Home Alone 3, was released in 1997, had entirely different actors and characters as well as a different storyline with Hughes writing the screenplay. It's kind of underrated, but not too good, but it's kind of an underrated fan. Moving on. A fourth made-for-TV film followed 2002, Home Alone 4, sometimes titled Taking Back the House,
The movie features some of the same characters who were in the first two films, but with a new cast and new storyline. November 12, 2012, a fifth film, Home Alone: The Holiday Heist, premiered during ABC's Family Countdown 25 Days of Christmas programming event with Malcolm McDowell as one of the villains. Similarly to the film, it does not focus on the McAllister family. Chris Columbus revealed at one point that there was a discussion of a sequel starring Kevin's son. This was talked about maybe 10 years ago. We were just having fun with it, and we said, what if Kevin is an adult and he has a kid? But it was still Patsy and Stern. Patsy and Stern still obsessed with this kid. They're going to get this kid. A sixth film was released digitally on Disney Plus on November 12th of this year, titled Home Sweet Home Alone. Devin DeRat Ray, whatever his name is, who played Buzz McCallum in the first two films, appeared in the film before he was arrested for something. I don't know. The point is, this is a movie that was super charming, super good, original, but then, you know, Hollywood couldn't let it go because it was so successful. You know, they couldn't let it go. They couldn't let something die as good as it is. They had to milk it for all it's worth and keep doing that, I guess, until we all die because, you know, it's Home Alone. I'm not feeling very great. I'm a sinner spy. I'll see you next mission.
Oh, I am not feeling too great. No. I won't take control. No. No. I will stay.